Hello, so today we will first revise what is ensemble average and then we'll go to see the ergodic hypothesis. So what is an ensemble? If you are supposed to study parameters of a particular system, instead of observing just that one particular system, you can make number of such identical systems. So whatever is your system, make some more identical systems. So if that number of identical systems is very large, then observing that larger group will help you in getting parameters which will be probabilistically correct. And that whole large group of identical systems is called as ensemble. Okay, that ensemble average of a parameter, that means you are trying to study parameter of the system, particular parameter of the system, then observing the ensemble, that means each and every system which is identical to the original system, which is part of this ensemble, and noting down what is the parameter value for each system in that ensemble, we can find out ensemble average. So y bar of ensemble is nothing but summation over r nu r y r divided by summation over r nu r, where nu r is the number of systems which have the value for this parameter y equal to y r. So all these nu r systems will have the same value for the parameter, and that is yr. So summation of all such values, that means the macro states, summation over all the macro states of this product divided by summation over r nu r, that means this is the total number of systems which are part of this ensemble. And then nu r upon nu gives you the probability for that particular macro state to exist, and that is then written as PR. So this ensemble average y bar can be written as summation over r PR yr, where yr is the value of that parameter in the rth macro state and PR is the probability of the rth macro state. So this ensemble is observed here at a particular instant. So you are observing all the systems which are part of that ensemble at a particular instant and noting down what is the value of the parameter y for every ensemble at that instant. Now we can have a different method, and that is if the system is tracked for very long time. Now we are not talking about the ensemble, we are talking about our single system. Now in the ensemble we had number of identical systems and we are observing all those systems at a given instant. Now here what we are doing is we are observing our one system for a very long time, where that time is almost infinity. Okay, and when we observe it for very long time, we keep noting down the value of that parameter y over this much time, and we may find that the parameter y has a certain value, say yt, for an interval delta t. This interval delta t need not be an interval at a stretch somewhere. Maybe right now I found that the value is yt for 1 second, then after some time I again find that value is same yt for half a second, and so on, adding all those small durations for which I get the value as yt. This interval delta t is calculated. So delta t is the total interval out of the total time t for which the system was being observed when we found that value was yt. Is that okay? So then the probability that parameter y has value yt is given as delta t upon t. That means we have observed the system for a very long time t. Out of this total time t, for the time delta t, the value of this parameter was yt. And so the probability that the parameter will have this value yt is given as delta t upon t. From here, we can again find the average of this parameter over time. Y bar time, here y bar time is equal to summation over t yt pt. Now what is that? Yt is the value of the parameter which is fixed value yt. Okay, so parameter y has value yt and that has a probability of pt. So it is same as yr pr, right? So here it is, instead of yr pr, we are writing yt pt, and we are taking summation over time. And this because we are observing it for a very long time, we are observing the system for a very long time, we can write this as limit t going to infinity 1 upon t integral 0 to infinity yt dt. And this gives us the time average of this parameter y bar. And then it is like if you have a set of 10 coins and you are throwing those 10 coins to see how many of those give you head. Okay, so you can do it in two different ways. One is you can take number of such sets of 10 coins and throw all the sets simultaneously only once and see in every set how many out of 10 coins are giving you head. Now if you find that if you have 100 such sets and out of 100 some number, say 10, give you head, only one coin giving you head. So that decides your value. Mu r equal to 10 for y r equal to 1. That means different numbers of coins giving you head will change from 0 to 10. It is possible that in one set, there is not a single coin giving me head. Whereas it is possible in some other set, I have all 10 coins giving me head. So I will have maximum possible macro states here will become 11. Okay. So the number of macro states is 11, giving the value of yr from 0 to 10. And for each y value, that is 0 to 10, we can find out what is the probability. Clear? At the same time, this particular experiment can be also performed in this particular way. Instead of taking those 100 sets of 10 coins, we just take one set of 10 coins and throw that 100 times or multiple number of times, say 1000 times. Okay, and every time find out what is the number of coins giving you head. Again, that number can change anywhere from 0 to 10. So now yt, let us say this yt is the number we decide right now here, say as 4 out of 10 coins, 4 coins should give me head. So out of 1000 times that you have thrown it, find out how many times you found that 4 heads are appearing. Okay, and then that time is this delta t, and this delta t upon the total number of observations, that is total number of times you have done this event, that will be this t, and this will then give you the probability of obtaining head 4 times. Okay, and so then we can find the average of the parameter, that is head appearing. This is the time average, and we can find it using this formula. Here then we come to one hypothesis, that is ergodic hypothesis, which says that y bar ensemble is equal to y bar time, which is equal to y bar experimental. That means if we actually perform experiment on this particular system and determine the value of this parameter, which is the average value, that should be equal to the average value which we can find using that one system and playing that game or doing that observing that event large number of times. Or we can have large number of identical systems and observing all those at the same time at one given instant and finding the average of this value. So y bar ensemble equal to y bar time is equal to y bar experimental is called as this ergodic hypothesis. Okay, now when out of total number of systems that is new in an ensemble, our ensemble is having new number of identical systems, and out of this total number new, the number in the rth macro state, it's a new r. Okay, then if this new r, that is the number of systems in the rth macro state, if that remains unchanged over time, where t goes to infinity, the statistical ensemble is said to be time independent. Now, what does this mean? If I'm saying that a particular macro state, say let's consider in the earlier way as we had considered four particles which have spin half, that means they can be either in state up or step down. Okay. Now, if we say that a particular macro state has two particles with spin up and two particles with spin down. And if we find that the number of configurations of that is, say, 6. Now, nu r, what is nu r? Nu r is the number in the rth macro state. That means if you have similar such systems, say 100 such systems of four particles, and if we find that out of these 100, 50 are in the particular macro state, giving the total magnetic moment zero. That is two particles with up state, two particles with down state. Okay, and if you keep it for a very long time, or if you observe it multiple times, and if you find that this nu r does not change, that is the number of systems in that particular macro state does not change, then we can say that the statistical ensemble is time independent, and the system in this situation is said to be in the equilibrium. The system is said to be in equilibrium if it is not changing its state again and again. It's remaining steady. It is not changing with time. Is that clear? Okay, but now here there is one catch, and that is when we are saying that system in this situation is said to be equilibrium. Now, when we say this situation, we have defined this situation as where this value, that is the number of systems in the particular macro state, is not changing with time. But within that macro state, there can be number of micro states giving you the same value for the parameter under observation. So it is possible that the particle configuration is changing, but it is not changing the value of that parameter corresponding to that macro state. So if the value of the parameter corresponding to that macro state is time independent, is not changing with time, the system is said to be in equilibrium. But even with that, the particle configurations may keep changing, giving you the same value for the macro state under observation. Okay, now let's come to this. If our system has a total energy of 10 units, that means whatever particles are there in the system, maximum energy of any particle is having can be only 10 units. No particle can have energy more than that. Okay, now let us say that the energy scale is divided into small intervals delta u. Okay, that means now if you have the total energy going from 0 to 10, you can make small intervals, say one unit I can make, or I can take this delta u even smaller than that. Okay, so this small interval is of energy delta u. Okay, now just see the next part. This delta u is very small compared to total energy of the system. So if the total energy is 10 units, I can take delta u, say just 0.1 units, which will be much smaller than this. Or I can take even smaller, 0.01 units, and so on. So we have assumed that the delta u is very small compared to total energy of the system. That is, delta u is small on a macroscopic level. That means when we say macroscopic level, we are talking about the parameter of a system. Now let's see the next part. But delta u is large on microscopic level. What does this mean now? When we talk about microscopic level, that means we are talking about energy of an individual particle. Okay. Now, delta u is large on microscopic level here means that there will be very large number of microstates in the interval delta u. Now, what do you understand by this? We have seen that for different macrostates, there are different number of microstates giving rise to the same macrostates. Okay, so if you have one macrostate somewhere here, okay, and if you have another macrostate with energy over here, the delta u is so much small that it is much smaller compared to the total energy of the system. But delta u is much larger in the sense that number of microstates over here is very large. That means maybe more than one macro state is covered by delta u, or if it is just one macro state within this delta u, the number of microstates for this particular macro state is much larger, and so over this delta u there are large number of microstates. Okay, so energy scale can be divided into small intervals delta u in such a way that delta u is very small compared to the total energy of the system. That means delta u is small on macroscopic level, but delta u is large on microscopic level. That means there will be very large number of microstates in the interval delta u. Okay, now how to write the equations. So let's come to this notations. Omega U, okay, remember the notations now. Omega U is number of microstates accessible to the system in energy level U and U plus delta U. So if we have considered delta U as an interval which is much, much smaller on the macroscopic level but much, much larger on microscopic level, from U to U plus delta U, there will be some number of microstates, and that number, that is the number of microstates accessible to the system. That means system can take place in any of these microstates. Okay, so the number of microstates accessible to the system having energy between U and U plus delta U is denoted as omega U. This omega U then can be written as rho U delta U, where rho U is the density of states. So if you have number of microstates over the whole energy scale, then rho U is the number of microstates per unit energy. Now you have seen from the earlier examples, we have seen already that the number of microstates goes on changing or decreasing as we go away from a macrostate. Macrostate is having a certain value of energy which need not be the maximum energy or minimum energy of the system. It can be somewhere in between, and often it is in between. Okay. Now, if the number of microstates within a macrostate which is away from the most probable macrostate is less, but delta U is same, or when we say one unit of energy, it remains the same. That means the number of microstates in one unit of energy goes on decreasing as we go away from the most probable macrostate. And so this rho U, which is the density of states, is a function of U. It is not constant over the full range of energy from minimum to maximum available for the system, that means available for every particle. Okay. Now, as delta U is very small, we are taking a very small interval. The change in rho U over the intervals will be small, because we are saying that this is our total range and delta U is just from here to here or from here to here. Now, delta U is very small, and so the interval which you are considering is such that the density change, okay, is very small, because you are going from one interval here, and I take one adjacent interval here, then another adjacent interval here. Compared to the density here, the density here will be different, but the change won't be much. That means if you consider the this energy, say, is a macrostate energy. Okay, so the number of microstates here is maximum. So here the density is maximum. And if I go away from this, as the delta U is very, very small, the change in density here to here is not much. Again, change in density from here to here, we are going away from the macrostate, so the density is decreasing, but the change is not much. The difference is very, very small. Now, as delta U contains large number of microstates, what we have said is delta U is small over a macroscopic level, it is small, but on the microscopic level it is large. That means the number of microstates within that is large. So it is possible that we are talking about two different macrostates coming up in that small delta U. So within this delta U, there are two macrostates. The microstates associated with this macrostate and microstates associated with this, both will come within this delta U. So as delta U contains large number of microstates, the density rho U will be a smooth function of U. So rho U, density of microstates, is changing as the energy changes. So it's a function of U, but it is not changing drastically. It is changing with a small, small change, and this rho U will be then a smooth function of U. Okay, now let another notation. Let rho phi U, we have defined omega U as number of microstates accessible to the system in the energy range U and U plus delta U. Sorry, now let us define another parameter. Another notation given here is phi U. So phi U is the total number of microstates below or up to energy U that are accessible to the system. That means from the minimum possible energy to the energy U. What are the number of microsteps accessible to the system? That is shown by the notation phi U. In that case, when we talk about omega U, which is the number of microsteps between energy U and energy U plus delta U, that is nothing but phi of U plus delta U minus phi of U, because this is giving you number of microstates accessible to the system from minimum energy to energy of U plus delta U. And this is giving you number of microstates accessible to the system from minimum energy to energy U. So this difference is nothing but the number of microstates within this interval delta U. That means, but that delta U is around you. So that means this difference is nothing but number of microstates accessible to the system in the interval U to U plus delta U. And this can be then written as d phi U by du into delta U. Okay. So this is the rate of change of number of microstates from minimum value to a certain value of energy with respect to the value of energy into the interval delta U will give us number of macrostates accessible to the system between U and U plus delta U. Are you with me till here? Okay, so now let's move further. Consider a system having a single particle with spin zero. Okay, have we done this earlier? Consider a system having single particle with spin zero, which is kept in a cubical box of length L. Right, we have done this before. Now, what is given here by saying that spin is zero? When it is given that spin is zero, that means s is equal to zero, we are already told what is the number of particle states. So each particle will have how many states to be placed in any given orbit. So the number of particle states is always given as 2s plus 1. So when we are told that the spin is zero, we know that this is equal to number of particle states is equal to 1. So this particle has only one space state to be in any particular orbit, not like earlier with spin of particles, it can have either up state or down state, but this one has only one particular state. Now the energy of this particular system is given as h square upon 8m l square into nx square plus ny square plus nz square. This is what we have already seen earlier. Okay, now let us consider a three-dimensional number space. What is that number space? Here, the energy depends on the values of nx, ny, and nz. So we are taking the number space. That means one axis is given or giving values of nx. This axis is giving us values of ny, and this axis here is giving us values of nz. Okay. Now consider a cube of unit dimensions. Now when I'm saying unit dimensions, here I'm taking, don't consider this as a sense of length as 1 centimeter or 1 meter, but this is unit dimensions in terms of this particular coordinate system where our axes are giving us the numbers, that is nx, ny, and z. So unit dimension is change in a value either nx or ny, nz by just one. Okay, so cube of unit dimensions is placed with one of its corners at the origin of this system. When we say origin of this particular system, we know that nx, ny, nz, minimum value for them is not 0, but it is 1. So in this case, the origin here will be 1, 1, 1 and not 0, 0, 0. Now when we place this cube over here in this particular coordinate system, as its length is 1 unit, at this point on the axis of ny, the value of nx, ny, nz at the corner of this cube, which is on the axis of ny, will be 1, 2, 1. Similarly, at the corner which is on the nz axis, the nx, ny, nz combination will become 1, 1, 2. On the x axis, it will become 2, 1, 1. Because we have started from the origin which is 1, 1, 1 and not 0, 0, 0. Okay. Now, this cube will have 8 such corners. And I have written here what will be the combination of nx, ny, nz at every corner. Okay. Now, these 8 corners of the cube will then show you 8 different states of the particle.
111 is one state or one orbit. 121 is another orbit, and so on. So the 8 corners of this cube will show you 8 different corners are associated with 8 different particle states. Okay. Now, if you are considering just one particle, here we have said only one particle. Consider a system having a single particle in a cubical box. Now, if you are considering only one particle which is there in this particular box, we can say that that particle can be at any one corner because it has to have some particular orbit to take place in. That means there are 8 orbits in which it can take place in. But if you look at the three-dimensional picture over here, you can see that there will be neighboring 8 cubes will have one corner common among themselves. So every corner of this cube will be shared by 8 such cubes. Are you getting this here? Okay. And this cube has its base in nx positive, ny positive plane. Okay. Now, if you consider a three-dimensional picture, here you will have one cube over here having base here, second cube having base here, third here, fourth here. All these 4 cubes will have nz positive, and similarly there will be 4 cubes with nz negative, and all these 8 cubes will be sharing this origin. Okay, so there will be 8 such cubes sharing this particular origin, that means sharing this particular orbit 111. And similarly, every corner of this particular cube will be shared among 8 cubes. So a particle inside this cube will find that there are 8 possible orbits for it to take place in. But for every orbit, there are 8 such particles, because there are 8 cubes sharing every corner and every cube has one particle. That means every orbit can be shared by 8 particles. And that means we can say that there is only one state available for the particle in one such box. So I'll proceed further here. Now, so consider a sphere of radius n, where this n is nothing but nx square plus ny square plus nz square whole raised to half. Okay. Now we know that energy is written as, I'll show you that equation again. Okay. We write the energy as h square n square upon 8m l square. And now I'm saying that let us consider a sphere of radius n. Okay. So the radius of the sphere is n. So I'm writing this as r now, as the radius of the sphere. So this r is equal to n. And using that equation for energy, we can write this n as l by h into 8me raised to half. Okay. So volume of this sphere is 4 by 3 pi r cube. Okay. Now when you talk about nx, ny, nz, okay, this n square is nx square plus ny square plus nz square. But nx, ny, nz are always only positive. They are never negative, right? That means out of this full sphere of volume 4 by 3 pi r cube, we have to consider only that part where nx, ny, and nz, all three values are only positive. So let's come to this again. So if you have full sphere here, cut the lower part where nz is negative. And so we are left with only half the sphere. Then you cut the part on this side where ny is negative. So we keep only with ny positive. So we have come to 1/4 of the sphere. Now you cut the part where the x, nx is negative. And so you are left with 1/8 of the sphere. Now the radius of the sphere is n. That means on the surface of the sphere, every point has the same value of n, which is root of nx square plus ny square plus nz square. So values of nx, ny, nz on the surface of the sphere at any point is not same, but the combination of nx, ny, nz on the surface of the sphere at any point will be such that n, which is root of nx square plus ny square plus nz square, is same. And if that is same, the energy at any particular point on the sphere should remain the same. And we find that we get the sphere volume for showing us that as the 1/8 of the total sphere volume 4 by 3 pi r cube. That means now this phi e, okay, what is this phi e now? This is nothing but the number of number of microstates which have energy starting from the minimum value to E, and that will be 1/8 of 4/3 pi r cube, because within this volume 1/8 of 4/3 pi r cube will have all the possible values of n which are from minimum value to the value that we have started with over here. Okay, and so this equation will be now 4π/3. I'm putting the value of r, that is the equation for r, over here, and I get 4π/3 l/h³ into 2m e^3/2. Okay, is this much clear? Now let's come to this. Mean energy of an atom at temperature, any temperature T, is written as 3/2 kT, because per degree of freedom the energy will be half kT. There are 3 degrees of freedom, so we write this as 3/2 kT. So at temperature of 273, if you calculate this by putting Boltzmann's constant over here and the value of temperature as 273, you will find that it is 5.65 × 10⁻²⁰ J. So mean energy of an atom, whatever atom it is, at temperature T is 5.65 × 10⁻²⁰ J. Okay, and we want to now find number of states available for helium atom in 1 mole of helium gas at STP. Okay, that means what do we want to find out? How many microstates are there which are accessible to the helium atom which is in 1 mole of that gas at STP? So phi of energy E, we have the equation here where now this E is less than or equal to 3/2 kT. Okay, so here phi of E is 4π/3 V upon h cube. We had L here, L cube. L cube is nothing but V. So V upon h cube. And here we had equation for that 2m e^3/2. Do you remember this equation which is written above here? Here, this equation we are using. Okay. So from here we get E written as 3/2 kT. Now, as we have already found out the value of 3/2 kT at T equal to 273 Kelvin, I am putting that value here directly. Okay, then it is a helium gas, so mass of that is 6.65 × 10⁻²⁷ kg. Okay, volume for 1 mole of a gas is 22.4 × 10⁻³ m³, and this is the Planck's constant, that is 6.63 × 10⁻³⁴ J/s. Okay, so putting all these values over here, what we are calculating is the number of microstates accessible to an helium atom in 1 mole of helium gas at STP, and we get that value as 2.1 × 10⁻²⁹ number of microstates accessible to a helium atom in 1 mole of helium gas at STP is 2.1 × 10⁻²⁹. And how many atoms are there in 1 mole of helium gas? That is of the order of 10⁻²⁷. Okay, that means per number of particles in 1 mole is 6.02 × 10⁻²⁷. Okay, that means there are about 10⁻⁶ states per particle. Are you getting me? In for a helium atom at STP in 1 mole of helium gas, the number of possible particle states is 2.1 × 10⁻²⁹. But in 1 mole of gas, there is not just one atom. There are 6.02 × 10⁻²⁷ atoms. So these many particle states are being shared by these many atoms. That means per atom, there are roughly 10⁻⁶ particle states are available. Are you getting me? Okay. So a particle or one atom of a helium gas in that 1 mole of helium at STP can be placed in any one of the orbits. If we say that if there are 2.1 × 10⁻²⁹ particle states which are accessible to these atoms, where there are 6.02 × 10⁻²⁹ atoms, and if we say that one atom in one orbit, there can be only one atom, still there will be only 6.02 × 10⁻²⁹ orbits occupied out of 2.1 × 10⁻²⁹. So there will be large number of unoccupied orbits, and then we can consider that the atoms are well spaced far away from each other.
So today we'll stop over here. In the next lecture, we'll talk about phase space. Thank you.